and welcome to the SWN podcast. We're back on a road trip. You can see me a little bit better this time because I have a tripod. So, but it's still quite dodgy on how I'm holding it up, so to speak. I'm your host as always, Billy, if I haven't said already, because I have memory of a goldfish. And we're en route to Inverurie for WrestleZone live in Inverurie at the Hopeville Social Club in Inverurie. Have I said Inverurie enough times? I think so. Looking forward to this. So we're leaving around about 2:30 because I've got to make a stop off in Old Meldrum. I will not bore you with that particular side of the trip. But as usual, I'll do some recording bits throughout the journey, I suppose. We'll do a little bit of a preview just now while I've got you here. While I can still... This is still up, and I know it's going to be like really wonky on the final product, but it's better than looking at my stomach, which I found awful to look at during the Wrestling Showdown episode and the Community Pro episode, because that was just not fun for me to look at, and probably wasn't fun for you guys either if you're on the video medium, which I hope you are. I always am an A what medium I'm concentrating on numbers wise, and audio is doing pretty good, at the moment, but I like the video medium more because, to be honest, I put a bit more effort into the video because, you know, you got to look at it, and if you got to look at me, I'd be as well put some effort into the actual production of it, as well, especially with, like, especially for these road trip ones, because we do the montage. And with the montage, you gotta watch it. It's all well good. Finding some video that I got off the video, some music that I got off the YouTube audio library, and listening to it for 3 minutes when you can go to YouTube and actually see the pictures that I've taken or videos that I've got or anything like that. So I've tried to do more of the YouTube stuff as well, but you know what? Let's talk about the show itself. So, it's sold out. I think maybe some tickets pop up every so often on WrestleZone's social media page, say that there's some available, or there's like one or two available, whether it's just families are no longer able to make the show or whatever. But as of recording, as of I'm aware of, the show is sold out in Inverurie at the Hopeville Social Club. So, it should be packed, which is fantastic, because it's like 25 degrees. So, it's going to be warm. It's going to be odorous. Is that the word we'll go? Yeah, odorous. I have packed deodorant because I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be the guy that people go afterwards going, oh, I saw the guy through who does the podcast stuff. You know, did he say much? No, he didn't say much, but he stunk. So I don't want to be that guy. I don't mind being quiet, but I'm not being smelly. So I've got deodorant. I am well prepared. I've also got my fancy little tripod here because I'm hoping to get some interviews with some of the guys before the show. That's the plan. Anyway, watch me panic when the tripod fails. That's going to be a lot of fun for people to see. So we've got that, and then we've got the show itself. So let's preview it while I'm just exiting Elgin, stuck around about for a moment. So the pre-show, we've got a triple threat. We've got Conor Malloy, Tommy Raiden, and Oliver Green, which is it's gonna be interesting because mainly because it's three like good guys. It's three guys that are fan favourites. So I'll be interested to see who takes on the aggressive role. There's a lot of stuff that I've kind of covered in the WrestleZone podcast. If you haven't listened to that yet, it's too late because the show's passed. So I think it'll be interesting who's going to be the aggressor, and I think it's going to be Conor. I think Conor is going to be the one that's going to show a little bit more of an aggressive side. I know I've said in previous podcasts like this that I've been waiting kind of for Conor to do something more aggressive, maybe a bit something with Ronan, you know, because they've been the Aberdeen Dream Team in Community Pro Wrestling. So I've been really wanting to see if they do any interaction with each other, and the starting point of that would be Conor being a little bit more cocky, being a bit more aggressive, and him having the experience, like much more experienced over Tommy and Oliver Green, makes it for something could happen, you know, something could happen about that. Tommy and Oliver, they seem to be kind of a little bit of a team at the moment on galas and stuff like that, as far as I've seen and are aware of. There's no one next to me. So we've got that kind of factor. They'll know each other quite well. Like I say, they are fairly new and inexperienced in comparison to Connor. So there's a lot of factors come into this. And with that means there's just a lot of intrigue, which, you know, that was my buzzword, it seemed, when I was doing the preview show for the WrestleZone podcast. So there's a lot of interesting dynamics that could take place. That beeping is saying I went over a line. Obviously not from what I'm saying, but from a physical standpoint on this car. So predictions. Kirsten and Louise asked for some predictions on Instagram. I'm predicting Connor, but with a caveat of if it's not Connor, I'm going to say Ollie, but Connor attacks Ollie. There we go. There's a controversial take there. Connor's got that title shot opportunity. He's got that like kind of guaranteed title match in pocket. I think he needs to start showing some aggression, and that he can get a singles title and get. I wasn't earn that place, but he's done that by winning the ladder match. So showing that he's got the championship chops in a singles capacity he's a former tag team champion, of course. I'm denied about this because I've also got predictions that like Aspen's going to finally be the big bad bastard again in WrestleZone by dismantling Conor Malloy if he cashes in a title opportunity against him. So about that, there's so much things that could happen. So my prediction is Conor. I'm going to stay with Conor with the caveat of if it's not Conor, I think Conor's going to do something about it, you know? So he's going to be the one that's left standing at the end of the pre-show. On to the main card. Watch me try to remember the matches. Three of them are very easy to remember. So we'll start with those three, because that seems like a good opportunity for me to wax lyrical about the foundation of the future and the outfit. So we'll start with, when you can find me again. I'm so sorry about this. It was actually better to see my stomach, I think. So we'll start with Ted O'Keefe and Zach Dynamite, and these three matches, the foundation of the future versus the outfit. My prediction, Zach. That's an easy one. Not so much a case of I'm dismissing Ted. I think in my mind anyway, if I'm looking at this logistically, like Zach has got so much more of a championship credential and all that kind of stuff. He's putting on some amazing matches in WrestleZone and everywhere else. And I think he's going to lead by example for the foundation and get the win over Ted. Ted's, well, had on main shows, what's he had? He came back at the Rumble, Anarchy, Nations. Was that it? Is that? And then he possibly did gala shows as well, but was that three matches on main shows? Was there a training academy show in between? There was, but I can't remember if he had a match. So less than five matches on main shows. I can confidently say that. He hasn't had a lot of matches back. He's been looking really good at those matches. I didn't see a training academy, but I've seen the other shows. So he's looking good in the ring. I think Zach won't be there to show he's the Aberdonian ace. I think he's more for revenge as well, because it was because of Ted O'Keefe. There's loads of distraction on the ringside, but because Ted O'Keefe took away the Tri-Counties Championship from Zach, which led to Caleb getting that spear, getting that hell ride, and ultimately winning the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship, he'll be there for a bit of revenge, just to put a beat on Ted O'Keefe. So I think Ted may have bitten off more than he could chew in that moment, and Zach's going to punish him for it. So I think Zach's going to win. When it comes to Dino and Bruiser Brad, I think we're not going to get a winner. That's That's where I'm thinking, that's where my head's going with this. I think this is just going to be two big guys, two huge guys, Dino and Bruiser Brad, just absolutely leathering the absolute piss out of each other for 10 minutes or so. And we're not going to get winner. I think this is the one that's going to be a big schmoz. I could say that about Ted and Zach, to be honest, as well. But I think this is the one where we're not going to get a finite winner. We're just going to get two guys battering each other, and then all things will break down, and then we can possibly revisit it in the future. In the foundation of the future. So I think this is going to be a lot, very hard hitting. I like the Hopeful Social Club, because I think, if I remember rightly, it's got a good ceiling, so we might get to see some cool things like suplexes and all that kind of stuff. And if it's two big dudes, that's always impressive to see. So we've got that, and we've got Murphy versus Ryan Riley. And I always have a soft spot for Ryan, so it pains me to say this, but I have a process of elimination here, so we've got a no outward winner of this showdown between the two teams. Ryan's got to lose to Murphy. Murphy has been doing great. He's been really improving himself. He's been doing that since he joined the outfit in Ellen way back when. So he's been really showing his improvement. He's been working with a better guy like Dino. So Dino's been able to help, I suppose, get that big man out of him. And working like a big man with his big splashes and some knobhead in a yellow car deciding to be really fucking close to me. Frick. So Dino and Murphy have been really working well as a team, and now they've got Ted, who's a bit more of a mouthpiece, although in himself has really improved as a wrestler, as a performer, I should say, because I can't really judge someone as a wrestler. I've never done it myself, but I could judge someone as a performer because I'm watching it. You know, I'm seeing what they're doing and I'm seeing their performance. I process elimination. Ryan Riley is going to lose to Murphy. So that way it would be one win, one loss, a draw. And then when I'm thinking about it in my wrestler nerd brain, this is where I'm going. It's raining. My God. And then that leads us to Halloween hijinks, maybe a 3-on-3. And throw in a Halloween brawl. Who knows? We'll see where we get from there. So I think that's where my brain's going. In predictions of those three matches, somehow, some way, it's going to be one win, one loss, and then one draw. Okay, I think that's what I'll go with that. So that leaves three more matches on the show, because I don't know whether it was just going to be all first half outfit versus foundation. That'd be quite cool. I don't think it will be, but we've got the other matches. Maybe we're just littered in, like alternating each match between the other matches. Where are we going next? Tag team match. We'll go tag team, because there's two triple threats, so we'll go tag team next. It is Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad against Captain Alan Sterling and Ronan King, and quite possibly will be the most fun tag team match I may ever seen. And this is a guy who's seen Mr. WrestleZone and Omar against Tucker and Dawkins, obviously Wally. So there's wrestlers against low life entities. So we've got that. That's right, and those guys are cyclists. So we've got, I don't know. This is a weird one, because Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad clearly still have a little bit of unfinished business with Tucker and Dawkins, right? I'll fight you at the beaches. Hello. God, right. I don't know what happened there. And my person not gone on. This is going terribly. Hello. I'm back. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know if I'm just going to do a technical difficulties thing, but if not, hello. Anyway, right, so. Yeah, Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Muhammad, they've got some unfinished business with Tucker and Dawkins. That really rattled me there. So sorry. This is a fun road trip episode. We've got that. We've also got Ronan King, who's looking like he's going to get a match with Kill Valhalla at Halloween Hijinks for the Tri-Counties Championship. So he's got to build some momentum with that, seeing as his last main show match was the Battle of the Nations, and he lost to Damien in a blindfold match. So he's got a little bit of momentum he needs to build back up. And then from that, we've also got Cumberland Allen Sterling, who won his match against Keegan Matthews at Battle of the Nations, but at the same time, he's trying to get a match with a pirate, Damien. So there's so many things that there's so many moving parts in this particular match, and I don't know how to break it down in my brain when it comes to trying to logistically think about who could win, what happened in the next show. I think it's just going to be an entertaining match, because we haven't seen Ronan and Captain Allen interact, as far as I remember off the top of my head. Of course, Omar and Mr. WrestleZone have more experience as a team, because they're teamed together, but they've got coming off that loss in their handicap match against Brian Tucker, so their confidence may be a little bit lower. They're a bit angrier, as their promo video put out. So we've got that to contend with and think about. And Captain Allen's got Damien on the horizon, Rodan's got Caleb on the horizon. Prediction, I'm going to say Ronan King and Captain Allen. And maybe we'll see the start, more cracks showing with Mr. Omar and Mr. WrestleZone as that unfolds. Because, you know, I hate friendship, it seems, when it comes to predicting stuff in WrestleZone. And I think we're going to see maybe cracks starting to show with Omar. I've been lying so many times today. With Omar starting to get a bit fed up of Mr. WrestleZone's antics. As far as costing him matches and being a bit of an annoyance in WrestleZone, in his WrestleZone career, which makes for interesting viewing, I think. Yeah, I'm going with that. So at least two triple threat matches, and then I can try and drive the rest of the way without throwing my phone everywhere. So I hope you enjoyed it. I hope it was clean. It's clean down there. You didn't get a view of anything too naughty. So what else then? So we've got triple threat matches. We've got gold non-title one first, which is Lost by Aspen against Damien and Reece Dawkins in a triple threat. Non-title match, and speed title's not on the line. Of course, Damien's got possibly Captain Allen on the horizon. Lost by Aspen's got Mickey Vago at Halloween Hijinks. And Reece Dawkins is just back, just returning to action after a broken wrist, and he's going into this match with a little bit of fear, because there seems to be an online social media campaign determined that Aspen is going to elbow drop his William Shakespeare book. So not only is Dawkins coming off a bit of ring rust, he's got a couple of gala shows behind him, so he's got a little bit of in-ring stuff to go on. This is his first proper match in front of a WrestleZone crowd since that injury at Auburn Anarchy. And he's also coming in with the fear that his book is going to get elbow dropped. So that's interesting. As far as the other two, Damien and Aspen, again, it's just a bit more of a momentum builder. They both came off wins at Battle of the Nations. I don't think Aspen's lost in WrestleZone this year. Again, on main shows, possibly. Since winning the title, anyway, I think I was doing the SWN 100 spreadsheet. I don't think he's lost yet in WrestleZone this year. I could be wrong. I could be missing a show somewhere, but I think that's right. So he's got all the momentum. Whether it's controversial after his win at Battle of the Nations, where Vago had his foot on the rope, that's not his fault. That's Dennis's fault. I assume he was refereeing. I can't remember off the top of my head. I'd always assume it's Dennis, though, if it's an error. So got that. Damien's coming off a win against Ronan. I still don't think that's 100% over. The blindfold match helped, like definitely added an extra chapter to it, but I don't think we've really seen the final come comeuppance of Ronan from Damien. So I think we're still a little bit there. He's got, but Damien's seemingly got Captain Alan at Halloween hijinks, because Captain Alan wants to get rid of Damien because he's a pirate, because he wears an eye patch. So we've got all that going on. So interesting triple threat. Prediction, you know, I'm going to pick Aspen. Of course I am. That's not a surprise there. Which I think it's going to add more interest though, because he's been undefeated since becoming champion, if I'm right in thinking that. Which makes it, whoever is finally going to beat Aspen, all the more sweeter, you know? For people that aren't Aspen fans, so it'll be terrible for me, but it'll be great for other people. That leaves the last triple threat, the Tri-Counties Championship match at Battle of Nations. I mentioned earlier, Caleb won the Tri-Counties Championship from Zach Dynamite, and he's going to fling straight into a triple threat match with the title on the line at Inverurie. I assume this will be the final match on the show. So it's Caleb versus Mickey Vago and Brian Tucker. Another very interesting triple threat match when it comes down to it. And I think Caleb's going to retain. I think that's not a foregone conclusion, but I think that's just the way it'll end up being. Because Caleb's got Ronan, and I really want to see that match at Halloween Hijinks, which I'm looking forward to. I've got my ticket for, so I should be going to that. So yeah, I think Caleb's going to win. But I think the match itself is going to be an absolute blast, because Vago has been really just striking it really well as a singles wrestler since the show's return back in October 21, which was the Halloween Hijinks. The match also involved Mickey Vago, which also involved Caleb Valhalla. So these guys know each other well. I think Vago's got the kind of win loss record over Caleb. Thanks to some mist, I think. When was that? Was that Hijinks the year before? Was that Hijinks last year? I think that was a Tri-County Championship match. Anyway, and Vago won using some green mist. So will Caleb know about that? We're seeing Caleb's learning more about the human world, about Asgard, in their videos recently, and I think they're amazing. I love Caleb. I think he's just excellent. Not only is he just a really fun wrestler to watch, I think he's just an absolute straight-up cool dude. You know, how old do I sound? He's a swell guy. He's a swell guy. So, that'll be a lot of fun. Brian Tucker is a bit of the unknown element here, because he is odd in the best possible way to describe him. Just odd right now. He's just a weird dude. So with that, I think he's a bit of an unknown quantity. Will he have Reese Dawkins in hand? Will Reese be backstage crying over his book being elbow dropped? That's another question mark there. I don't know. So like I said, I think Caleb's going to retain. That's my prediction for that. And yeah, what's going to happen? I don't know. That's for me to find out, to me to watch, because, you know, that's what I'm here for. I'm here to watch the wrestling. I'm here to enjoy it. I'm here to write about it and speak about it, and then for a handful of people to read and watch it. And, you know, that's what life's like as part of SWN. In the meantime, I think that's enough. That's what, 23, 25 minutes that I've rambled on here. Whether I've cut out the bit where I dropped my phone and it fell between my legs, and that was a whole thing. But I'm now in Keith. The place, not the person. Get your mind out of the gar. So I better go and complete the rest of my journey. Maybe stop and get a drink or something, because it is absolutely boiling. Maybe get the aircon on, because I turned that off so you can actually hear what I'm saying. I think I've mentioned all the matches. Yeah, I have. So 6 matches, 1 pre-show match. Hopefully to get some interviews with some guys. That'll be what you'll be seeing in a little bit. Littered possibly in between a montage or two, depending on what I get at the show. Hopefully get some videos, so I can use it for some YouTube shorts, some photos for the montage, etc, etc. So this is me signing off, I suppose. I'm going to wait until I get around this corner here so I can hit the button. So like I say, possibly it might be an interview, it might be the rain, it might be me stopping to get some food. I don't know. So I'll see you in a second. Have a good one. Bye. we have made it. I'm in Inverurie. About an hour before I get in and do some interviews. Why am I saying it like that? I don't know. But I've parked up. Got a nice parallel parking spot right outside Strachan's. It was like it was meant for me. There's a charity shop next door. There's a Greg's. So I'm going to go and visit both. And then it's off to the Hopeful Social Club, which I think I remember where it is. So, ace. This has been a fairly uneventful trip, except I almost crashed on a dual carriageway. And then and before that, you got a nice view of my crotch. I haven't looked at the footage. I assume my crotch is bulged right into your face at some point if you're watching the video version. In the meantime, right, I'm going to go and look for some bargains while that place is still open. It's open until 5, ace. And yeah, Greg's me up. There's the Wetherspoons down the road. I might go there. I don't know. We'll see. That's the mystery. That's the mystery of the show. I don't know what's going to happen. So next thing should be some interviews. So let's see who's up first. It is this guy.
So I am backstage. I'm backstage. I don't know where we are.
We are staged.
I'm somewhere. Hopeful Social Club, and I am joined by the one and only Blue Thunder.
Good eve. I'll wait for the people watching this in video format.
I've wanted to get Blue Thunder on for a while. He is. He has rejected my advances at any turn, but
that's not true.
I've somehow got you on for a minute. It is roasting in here.
It's unbearably warm. It's the joys. You never know. September dates. It's either going to be a monsoon outside or it's a tropical heatwave. And this year we've got the heatwave, so all the joys of the fair.
We still have to wrestle.
No, and that's good for everyone. That's good for everyone.
You can find a couple of fans, you know, actual fans, not the people that are being.
And they've been hidden for personal usage, yes.
Yes. No, it should be a good show tonight. I'm looking forward to it.
Always look forward to the show. Always look forward to the last time here. You were here last year.
I was. Yes. Yes.
The last year was a good show for a new venue for us.
All right.
It was nice being here for the first time. We had a nice receptive crowd, and tonight it's almost twice as busy as it was last year. So very much looking forward to it for the guys who are taking to the ring tonight. They'll have a good one.
Yeah. Well, last time I was here, Brian Tucker almost killed himself. So that was
standard fare.
I might see if I can find him, but I don't know if he'll be elsewhere trying to avoid me. as most folk, I think, will be. But no, it's sold out. 25 degrees
at least.
Perfect. There's a door over there that may or may not stay open. I think I've heard rumblings that it won't.
Sit close to that.
But no, it's just yeah, I wish I had more stuff prepared for these things, but I don't know who I'll get.
That's true. Yeah,
so cool. That's it. But it's just I'm roasting. I wish I could think of more, but
it is distractingly unbearably warm.
That's it. It's
not beautiful.
It's really not.
And he is of the balding on top nature, so it's worth it.
I wonder where you're going with that, because I'm quite rotund as well, and it's
extremely bad.
That's fine. But no temptations to get back out now. You're quite happy with your commentary role now.
My body is, apart from my throat, the day after. I was a bit apprehensive at first, didn't know how it was going to go, didn't know if I would take to it, and I've never tried anything like that before. No, I've thoroughly enjoyed it. James Chesser, who sits with me, he's a very good guy. He trained with us for a little while, he's a referee for a little while, he's a bit of jack of all trades. He's a good guy, he's great to play off of. Thoroughly enjoyed it so far. Long may it continue. And anything that keeps my broken old brittle bones out of the ring is good for me and everyone else.
Perfect. Well, look forward to the show tonight. Steve, how did we get 3 minutes out of this? With me just being
We talked about the weather for 2.5.
I don't think that is it. And you being fat. But no, looking forward to the show. I'll probably sit near you so I can hear the commentary, because I'm too thrifty to buy new ones.
I'll come and whisper sweet nothings in your ear.
Wonderful, can't wait. Thank you very much.
Just how much I'm gonna batter Omar Muhammad tonight. I'm Mr. WrestleZone, Billy.
Forgot your mask. I thought you were with Captain Allen, but you're
I am Captain Allen. I don't even need Captain Allen.
So I am joined by Ronan King. Last time we had you on, you just swore in front of a crowd. So it's been quite a journey since then.
It's been a while. I've grown a lot. I keep my language to myself now, and in my mind. See, when I see a fan, I'm like, they're an ugly fan. I keep it to myself now. I don't say it out loud anymore.
We don't bleep this, so it's even
That's rare. Great, that's great. You know what? I hope you know that. I think all of you are ugly cunts. But I keep that to myself.
I'm a retired fan, so I'm the medium. So yeah, we've got a match tonight with Omar Mohamed and Mr. WrestleZone. It's an interesting match. I said in my preview that I don't know what's going to happen, but it seems like a very odd affair. But you've got Kyle Valhalla, so is this a tune-up for that?
Yeah, you know what? I'm going to drop Omar and Mr. WrestleZone on their heads, just like I'm going to do to Caleb next month when I'm going to try catch up. See both of them, boot, their face, easy. I don't even need Alan. Alan's just there. He's my hype man tonight.
I'm looking forward to this. One of the matches I'm looking forward to as well.
Good, as you should. I'm in.
So you've got Discovery, you've got so many places that you're at now. So what's the goal now? Is it just win titles?
Just be the best ever. I mean, I'm already the best ever. But you know, make sure everyone knows I'm the best ever. Win all the belts. Every single belt. Thanks 2 years. Every single belt around my waist. Guaranteed. Yeah. No one in wrestling is on my level. Just wait.
A nice way to round off. Thank you very much for playing.
No worries, anytime.
Looking at my car. I'm not sure what it is.
Yeah, he's trying to figure out if it's a spaceship or if it's like a horse-drawn car. He's like, where's the horses and everything?
I don't. We told him horsepower and that was it. I am joined here by Omar Mohamed. I just spoke to Ronan King.
Yeah, I saw you from there. I don't know. Was he bad mouth for me?
He's calling on fans cunts, so it's went well.
Oh, right. Well,
went as well as really thing interview for you.
You're going to have to bleep that. Yeah. I mean, I don't know. No?
No, I don't bleep. No, stop.
Well, piece of shit.
But no, I'm glad to see you. I think you've actually been on the podcast the most at this point.
I think I have. I think this must be a record. I don't know. Is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing?
I don't know. You've definitely been on at least a few. And last time we spoke on this would have been the quiz. So that was.
I feel like it's now like.
Disaster.
You were saying how I've been on the podcast the most, should I? Yeah?
Okay, what do you want? Where's your bag?
Where do you want my bag?
Because I've lost my spare bag. I don't know what it's spare bag.
Okay,
I'll...
Do you
want to get your...
Okay, you can talk to Mr. Breath as well.
Oh, God.
Right.
Right. Damn! Jump on it!
No, he's not in the match.
Your move, and you do it.
Great. Your masks are best quick, the nose is coming
out. Don't even worry about it. Don't even worry about it. You worry about the chop wire. That's my fourth favourite move.
Yeah.
Right now.
See what I have to deal.
The chop wire is my fourth favourite move. Now.
What do you want? This is the first time I think he's
been. This is the first time. Mr. Wrestle was definitely someone I really wanted on.
No. I completely understand what's happening because we are going to be. Hi. Hi, everyone. We are going to be on the internet where literally an entire city of people are going to watch the best wrestler in the history of ever. Mr. Asian Sensation Omar Mohamed. Blue Thunders went outside for the waters. And now we're in Inverurie. So we can have a fight. And someone's going to get their bum punched. It might be Mr. Billy Strachan. If he does anything to upset me, like calling you not the best wrestler ever. Ever.
I mean, we know he's not.
That's so solid. Imagine you hit that. You would never move again.
Hopefully that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
And you know who's not the best wrestler in the world?
Yeah.
Ronan King, because he tweeted that one white.
Ronan then, King.
B22. Remember it well.
On the interwebs.
On the Twitter. X.
Ronan King, an actual true king, and I'm going to prove it tonight. And Captain Alan Starlight, who's never been near the water in his life, because he's actually Colonel Sanders.
Oh yeah, is KFC hello?
He's a chicken boy! He's a chicken boy!
He's a chicken boy?
K and an F and the C. And I'm also going to prove that tonight, that he isn't a captain. Imagine going to a public place dressed like Captain Alan Sterling. It's mental. Why am I so close to Billy? Oh, Mr. Mohamed, where are you going? I hope you enjoyed tonight, Billy. And I also hope that you will cheer and make noise. Because it makes me happy, and when I'm sad, bad things happen. I'm away! Mr. Rose Carter!
Off.
fancy, I know.
You want me to look into the camera?
You can do whatever you want, sir.
Okay.
So I'm joined by, it's now Dave Patterson.
Yeah.
Not Mr. P anymore.
Yeah, not Mr. P. No. You know, I've got the old suit on and everything. So I've still put the tie on and whatnot. But Mr. Patterson. WrestleZone management. That's what we do.
Once again, I think that's the first time I met you. You were part of management. That was Abrianarchy 2013.
Yeah, we kind of call it, you know, the full circle type moment. I came in as WrestleZone management and then jumped by Johnny Lyons.
Okay.
So I thought I'd give it a go. And I think so for 10 years I was wrestling as Mr. P. And now it's just, you know, I'm at that age where, you know, it's catching up with me. So I thought, you know, they asked me to come back. Mm-hmm. And here I am.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to it. As you've got management decisions now,
yeah,
have you found Super Executioner at all? Just out of curiosity.
Yeah, Super Executioner, he's a hard one to track down. Mm-hmm. He doesn't answer his phone that often, so he's a difficult one. But he's, you know, he's like a bad smell on a bus. You know, he's like, he's there, you know. And he'll be back. He'll be back.
Oh.
He'll creep up now and again. You just never know where.
You've made my day.
What's this space?
Like
I'm sure we'll find him.
Like I was saying to you, I haven't spoken to Ryan on this yet, but he told me that he's sleeping through the night, no bother, since having a child. So that's cheered me up because I was almost irreverent. I don't know what the word is. Very angry at finding that out.
Yeah.
So I can't wait for the show. It's sold out in Inverurie.
Yeah, we've had a bunch of sellouts. I don't know. You know, ever since COVID, and then we start putting on shows. I think everyone has been a sellout.
I think so.
You know, but now we've had a string of sellouts, and we're not taking it for granted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but it just shows there's up here. They want to see wrestling.
Yeah.
I think it's just the live action. You know, and to sell it again in Inverurie, where were we before? We were at the Station Hotel. Before that was Anarchy. We're in a string of sellout shows, getting bigger and better. The guys are improving every show. So, you know, again, onwards and upwards. Mm-hmm. We're just at a good time for WrestleZone.
Excellent. And any exclusive, where is there any new venues next year that you can possibly, I don't need to know when and where, but
yeah,
just is there going to be some new venues?
Yeah, there will be. We're always on the look for ones. And we're going to Stonehaven next month, I think it is. October, we've got the Halloween show.
Yep.
But then the following month, we've got Stonehaven, and that's a new venue at the Station Hotel. So we're trying out new venues all the time. Obviously the ice rink this last couple of years, I'm a big fan of the ice rink venue.
I like Curly,
it's a packed small venue, you know what I mean? There will be new venues, but I can't tell you right now,
because
until it's signed on the dotted line, I can't tell you.
That's fair. I'm still hoping for Keith. I've earmarked that's the first one that my boy's going to.
Yeah,
it's a Keith show.
I do miss the sort of smaller outlying Aberdeenshire, Murray Village. Keith's not a village, is it? It's a city, probably, is it?
I have no idea, to be honest. I drive through it, I don't really stop.
But yeah, Keith was one of my first matches, I think. I had my first match with Keith.
Huh.
Yeah, so there you go.
Wonder if I was that, I can't remember.
I think we should go to Keith.
I agree, because Jack needs to go see some wrestling, and we've determined WrestleZone's first. It has to be first.
Yeah, it has to be.
Our show's coming to Elgin, and that's great, but it has to be WrestleZone.
And he'll
first.
Get into it. He'll be loud.
He better
love it.
I've got a 16-year plan. As soon as he's old enough, he's coming here to train.
Yeah, he's training. I'll probably still be here.
I'll do the John Cena thing. I'll be his dad becoming the manager.
We'll try and find a spot for you.
Absolutely perfect. But look forward to the show. Thank you very much for taking the speed.
No problem. Thanks for coming to the show. Hope you enjoy.
I'm joined here by the mighty Kill Valhalla, his Tri-Counties Championship.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
I had to get the camera all the way up so we could see the regalia.
Yes!
I had to see the cape.
Yes. Lots of compliments about the cape, thank you.
I love the cape.
Yes. And the belt's beautiful too.
The belt is a beautiful belt, yes. You're defending the title tonight.
Tonight!
Triple threat.
Yes, Vago and Tucker.
Tucker.
Yes.
Molly.
And his librarian friend, maybe.
Oh yeah, I heard his book's getting elbow dropped tonight.
Oh! That's a shame.
Oh,
yeah. He loves that book.
Have you read any Shakespeare?
Read?
that's fair. Fair enough. So at the moment, online we're seeing a lot of you discovering new things in the world in Midgard.
Yes. You've got a beautiful realm.
Light switches.
Look at this beautiful tree.
Of course the tree.
Big beautiful tree. Big beautiful tree. Big beautiful Caleb. Big beautiful Melt. It's a lovely realm.
Beautiful. Anything else? Anything new that you can reveal?
Skullboarding.
Skullboarding.
I'm loving skullboarding.
Safety first, wearing a helmet and everything.
Yes, of course. Safety, very important. Wear a helmet if you're out skullboarding. Very important. Don't want to hurt your head. It's very important. Listen to the mighty Caleb.
That's a beautiful lesson to him.
Safety! Be safe! Or I will send Sorcerer Raspin after you. You will wield his magic, his lights, and ways of this world.
And the fridge was up to
the fridge. Let's walk away now. Goodbye.
Thank you.
John Cena. I'll turn off the music. There we go. I don't want to get a copyright strike. Yes, we're on the drive home from Inverurie. WrestleZone has taken place. You're seeing nothing. This is mainly great for audio content. I had a great time. It was a sweltering venue. I'll get a bit more of a proper kind of breakdown of the show when I record the next bit, which will probably be Monday or Tuesday. But what I can say is it was an absolute blast. Even though, like I said, the venue was sweltering, there were some fans about, and not just in the seats, and they tried their best to cool down the place, but it wasn't happening. It was just absolutely roasting. The toilets were great. They were nice cool down before the interval as well. It was just a really fun night, as it always is at the WrestleZone shows. Like I said, I'll do a bit more of a breakdown in the next section. I'm just going to give you my fresh hot takes while I'm still on the move at five past ten. I have made excellent time. I'm not going to lie, I've made some fantastic time. The venue got out about not even an hour ago from the show, and I'm motoring my way home for a relatively early night. I mean, I'll put the results up and all that kind of stuff as well, but it's been good fun. So you saw the interviews. I got a good few interviews in, which I was buzzing for. Thank you very much to WrestleZone for being so accommodating. I'm hoping I'll be able to do the same at Halloween Hijinks and maybe get a few more people that I didn't get on this one. But I got Mr. P. I got a little bit of Aspen. I got a good one, Caleb. I got two with Caleb, so I don't know which one will be going on there, or maybe both of them, and I'll do some good, like spicy stuff. I got some Mr. WrestleZone stuff. I got Blue Thunder, where I'm glad because I wanted to get Blue Thunder on the actual proper show. So I'm glad I was able to get a couple minutes with him. I wish my question set was a little bit better, but to be honest, I was sweltering. I was probably dehydrated. I was just knackered, and I tried to get as much as I could from my own brain out, so I could get some questions to Blue Thunder. But I'm glad that I finally got him on the show, some way somehow, as well. But no, it was good fun. It's a good venue there in Inverurie. The second time they've run it, because they used to do the town hall, and it's a nice little venue. I was completely wrong when I was saying that it was a high ceiling. I was completely wrong. It is not a high ceiling at all. So much so that you may have seen the montage. Brian Tucker got stuck in the ceiling. Some were victims of it. I think there was only one victim of the ring, and who was it? Oh, I think it was possibly Tommy Raiden. I can't remember. I think there was one almost victim of the ring, being the lower setting. But no, everyone else was fine. The matches were great. My predictions, terrible. I got the pre-show match right, I think. Connor winning. When it came to the foundation, I got half right, because I got that it was going to be a win either side and then a draw. That was kind of my thought. It was going to be, what was my prediction? Murphy winning, Zach winning, and then the Dino and Bruiser Brad being a draw. So it turned out to be Ryan winning over Murphy, Dino winning over Brad, and then Dynamite and Ted being the big schmozen draw, no contest kind of thing. So I'll give myself half a point for that. Tag team match I got wrong. Omar and Mr. WrestleZone won that one. The two triple threats I got right. So not a bad night when it comes to predictions for WrestleZone. We've got Halloween Hijinks up next on the 21st. That's a double recording weekend, because I'm planning to be at Wrestling Showdown as well for their season premiere at the Town Hall in Elgin. So that's my plan for that. So that'll be fun. The next batch of my next show is Fair City Wrestling Ardler Mania. That'll be next week's episode, I think I've got a couple interviews in the interim that'll be released in that time. So there's a lot of stuff going on in the podcast world, and I've had a really good time at WrestleZone tonight. They provide top quality entertainment. I wish I could do the same when it comes to recording on the way home, because I don't want to put the light on. I always remember when you're younger, even though I don't think it's even the case, if you put the light on that's just above you in the car, it's illegal. And I'm almost positive it's not, but not positive enough for me to do it. I think I may have done it in a past episode, and I felt like, oh my god, the police may come to get me, you know. It was great seeing everyone at the show tonight. It was great seeing Kirsten supporting SWN What's Your Favourite Dinosaur t-shirt. Amazing. I haven't seen anyone else wear a t-shirt like that in the wild, other than myself. I know some people have bought the t-shirts, and I've seen the pictures of people wearing them, but I've never actually seen the t-shirts in real life. So that was cool. It was so cool to see that. As always, I wish my face would show it. I've got right one of those faces that just says fuck off. But it was, yeah, good time was had. I had a little table next to me, which was great. I put my phone on there and kind of a leaning on it. It was the little things, because I'm 33 years old and broken. My body is just a broken shell of a human. I would say it's due to a one-year-old, but it's really not. It was like that before, pre-Jack kind of state. I'm just a very unhealthy human. Like I said, I'll maybe talk about the show properly in the aftermath. I've got the WrestleZone recap to record Monday morning. Then I've got a chat with Daisy Jenkins. It's a really busy week coming up. I mean, all by the time this episode comes out, I should have recorded all of them. So I've got Daisy Jenkins, then I've got Ruby Roberts coming back on, Casino Brutale coming back on. I've had them on separately, but it's for them together. Then I've got Drew Mercury, who's tearing up down in Glasgow area. And then I've got The Wanderer back on to talk about Ruggie Slam. Archery Pro Wrestling's event at the end of September. And then I think by the time I've done all those, I've got episodes plotted along with the road trips that I haven't been on yet. I've got episodes right up until the start of November, which is ridiculously organised for me. There was a point, like in the first season and second season, that I had episodes done 3 months in advance. So I'm never going to be like that again, or I'm going to try not to be. A month would be kind of the maximum. I would like to have an episode just sitting there waiting to go out. But I'll be on Patreon in the meantime, you know. So, with that. So, I guess I got a good few interviews or a good few little bits about the show, which you would have hopefully have heard or seen now. And then they'll go out as on-location episodes in the coming weeks or week, fortnight or so. On the ride up to Halloween hijinks. We've had a really good time at WrestleZone. I started this recording bit as I was leaving Fockburs, and we're just about at Elgin. So I'm not going to keep you on for 25 minutes like I did in the first part, because, you know, it's 10:15. That's like 1:15 past my bedtime now. It's been a fantastic night. Lots to think about, lots of theories, you know, you can think about for possible future things coming up in WrestleZone. Obviously, none of my wild conspiracy theories of Conor Malloy being a bad guy, just end of friendship between Omar Muhammad and Mr. WrestleZone, none of that happened. But, you know, I hate friendship, it seems, because I'm wanting all the good guys to go, nah, I won't be friends with you. I'll punch you in the face instead. A lot of hilarious moments. Mickey Bagel did the absolute cleanest cartwheel back elbow. It was a thing of beauty. We had that, and we had things like Rhys Dawkins. He got his book was elbowed. Shakespeare book was elbowed. Got the elbow drop. We got things like Bruce Brandino was phenomenal. I am in the wrong lane. I am just going to just sneak my way over here. Rhys Dawkins getting sprayed and missed in the face by Mickey Vago. He had his glasses on, so he took his glasses off to go, ha-ha, and then got sprayed in the face by Vago without his glasses on. Oh, it's just... There's so many wonderful comedy things that WrestleZone does, and the guys that they have on their roster do so well. Things like Ronan. Mr. WrestleZone had gifts for Ronan and Brian Tucker, of which being a crown for Ronan that was just a couple sizes too small, and then a bucket of Captain Allen, I can't remember what I said, a bucket of KFC, an empty bucket of KFC for Captain Allen, because Mr. WrestleZone thinks that Captain Allen is not a sailor or captain of the seas. He's Colonel Sanders, and he runs KFC. You know, it makes sense in context, I think, possibly. If it doesn't, I still enjoy it. I think I am near home. So, what's it been, like 10 minutes? That's plenty of me rambling stuff after a show. You can, next time I'll be in the studio. I'll be doing... You'll see my face. That's probably the most important thing, especially when it comes to watching the YouTube version, because all you're seeing at the moment is my steering wheel, because I'm not having a fight at this time of night with that bloody selfie stick / tripod thing, which worked great at the show. I need to learn how to hold it, you know. I'm not used to holding something so big, so I've got to learn how to do that so it looks so you guys will see me a little bit better. We'll have to learn how to crop some videos a little bit, because I'm like, you only see my head. Because I kept looking back at the wrestlers and didn't actually think about looking at the video itself too often, which, you know, probably would have been handy to do. I'm still rambling. Let's go. I'm going. So next thing you should see is the aftermath in the studio. So, cool. Here I am. We're back in the studio. Everything is fixed and works, I think. Although I did have some problems with the headset in our Arcade Violence interview, which hasn't gone out yet, so that there's time will tell. But we're back in the SWN Towers, aka my office,
aka the spare bedroom that's become my office. And it's a couple of days removed from WrestleZone live in Inverurie, and put the results in front of me so I can kind of remind myself. We probably will have something in writing after this episode goes out, or before it. I don't know. I somehow don't make the rules on my own website. But the show itself, like I probably said in the segment in that you could see nothing in because I was in the car and the phone was pointing upwards and you couldn't see me because it was dark and I wasn't fighting with that tripod again. After incident in the first half that had me just like I say, went everywhere. It was safe though, just for anyone who's watching that going, oh my god, he's filling that while he's driving. It was literally, I do have it here. Give me a second. This is great audio content. It was this for people that are on the visual. So phone went in there and then I put this bit like in the bit where you put all the crap in your car. And it held up pretty well and then it fell and I had to lift it back out and try to put it back in the hole. But this is what it was. So this is what you see what I'm holding during the little interview segments that we got as well. That's what it was. I was holding that. So I've learned watching those back. I need a steadier hand, so that's good to know. I definitely need a steadier hand when it comes to trying to use this thing, but hopefully I'll be using it again for Ardler Mania and I'll just use it as a tripod. I'll just actually have it held up as a tripod and get some interviews. My current plan is just to kind of hole up myself somewhere in Ardler Complex, have it set up on a table, have a couple chairs next to it, and let people just come to my little corner and we'll have some chats. So it could be a big episode next week. It's a big episode this week. I'm surprised about, like, this is before I've put this bit in. It's 55 minutes it's sitting at the moment, and that's with the montage, the pre-show bit, the interviews that we got, and some other little bits and pieces as well. So it's quite a big episode already. Show itself though, like I say, it was great fun. I was absolutely sweating the whole time though because of the heat. I think when we left Elgin, it was 25 degrees and it rained a little bit in Keith. I was super excited because I thought, oh my God, rain. Yes. Oh, I was buzzing for it. And then, yeah, then it didn't rain again. It just got hotter and hotter. And as we got to the venue, I kindly was allowed to do some pre-show interviews, which you hopefully have seen or listened to by now, by the time this bit is happening. So I got to chat with a good few folk. I got to see kind of a little bit of the behind the scenes stuff. Not too much because I like doing the backstage stuff. I like doing the interviews and that. But I'm happy not to see this sausage being made. I suppose that's probably the best way to put it. I'm happy not seeing the sausage being made. So because I've been to shows in the past where I've done like some running about for folk, and I've seen them go through segments and bits and pieces of matches, and I'm like, I don't need to see that. That's the kind of bits I don't need to see. I'm happy to do the interviews, but I don't pay attention to the bit happening in the ring because I want to be surprised on the show itself. So that's why the first couple interviews are done inside, but because it was so loud with the ring and whatever and bouncing ropes and that, we took it outside, and which is a bit better. And it again because it was so hot in the venue at Hopeful Social Club. So. Recap, I've went through the results, a little bit of bits and pieces. There's not an awful lot I can really add to this bit. So I'm hoping to write some bits and pieces down. But what I can say is the show delivered once again. So this is the second time they've been at Inverurie Social Club, Hopeful Social Club in Inverurie. And second time that I've been to those shows as well. I forgot that it was a lower ring with a low ceiling. But no, I don't think anybody fell for it. I think maybe Tommy Raiden almost found himself arse over TKL right at the start. But after that, I don't think anyone else really did. It did see, there was a lot of kind of adjustments to some maneuvers. We'll see in the montage, there was like Zach Dynamite's apron leg drop. It didn't look as pretty as it could be with a higher apron. But the show itself, the matches itself were absolutely incredible and fantastic. Start with Conor Malloy defeating Ollie Green and Tommy Raiden. I said on Twitter, and I've probably said in the recap video as well, that I really liked that Blue Thunder was doing the ring announcing for this one because it's him advertising the training academy and trying to get people involved because you know, more wrestlers training, more wrestlers on shows, and new opportunities, especially now that a lot of WrestleZone guys are getting picked up and getting used elsewhere and they're traveling all over the country right now. So it means that they can do that and not have to worry about WrestleZone being short, I suppose, in that respect, possibly, with that. So Connor Malloy from Forest, Ollie Green from Elgin, and Tommy Raiden from Ellen. So that was a nice mix and pot. And as Dennis Law pointed out, who I don't think I've got any complaints about his refereeing. This might be the first time I've got no complaints on Dennis Law's refereeing on a show. So time will tell. I might find a way to be annoyed by it. So yeah, and Dennis Law pointed out he's from White Hills. So it was a really nice mix and bowl melting pot of from the Northeast that were in that match. And Connor picked up the win. I loved that kind of aggressive side because he was the experienced one. He was able to almost bully his way into matches, into the situations, because he's got the more experience, probably the stronger of the three as well. And it worked into his favor. So a really good match. I've really enjoyed the pre-show matches. They're a nice little bit of fun that hopefully adds to further stories down the line, because we saw it last month at Battle of the Nations when the Outfit just demolished their opponents. Like, it was Tommy, Ollie, and Air Miles. And then it led to them being a formidable force as a trio into the Foundation of the Future stuff. So it all worked out that kind of way. And Connor Malloy obviously has that tag team, that title opportunity that he won at Aberdeen Anarchy in hand. So he put on a fairly dominant display in the match as well for building to a possible title opportunity. I'm still thinking it's going to be against Aspen, and I still think he's going to get destroyed, but I think it's going to be for the greater good. Opening show, I think I said it in the recap as well. So a lot of the time I'm going to say, I think I said it in the I loved it. Opened with the Foundation of the Future music and the Outfit music for Ryan Riley and Murphy, and the next match the same. I really hoped they did it for three times in a row for my own enjoyment, but they didn't. They put Ted O'Keefe and Zach Dynamite onto the opening of the second half, but just for my own enjoyment. I did see some people going what when the second match started, and it was the Foundation music and then the Outfit. But the matches itself, I called it was going to be one win for one team, one win for the other, and then a draw. But I absolutely shat the bed when it came to who would win what. Ryan Riley and Murphy put on a really great match. And Murphy is really, I was concerned about him with maybe crowd interaction, because I don't think that's something that's possibly his forte. That's why it was great to see like Ted coming back and Dino's a bit more with the crowd, but he held his end of the bargain. So they had a really great match. A lot of thinking, like I've been pointing out recently, that Ryan Riley's a bit more of a cerebral wrestler. He thinks his movements through, he takes advantage of situations, but he does it with some thought or logic, like logistically, why he's doing this, why he's doing that, as opposed to the Brad, who's just a wild man who will just batter people and be the beef king. So that's how that kind of dynamic really works well. And so Ryan had a lot of moments where he was showing he's a thinking man's wrestler. He's able to avoid situations, put Murphy into situations where Ryan would have an advantage. There's a really, really great moment with the ropes. It'll be in the montage with Murphy being tied up into the ropes. And it showed that Ryan is quick thinking, but his hesitation for a moment just cost him a moment in a match. And it was just when Murphy was tied in the ropes and Ryan turned away to go run to the ropes and do a knee to the face. And in that moment he turned away, Murphy got out of the ropes. And the timing was just impeccable for that moment to work, because it could have been you could have seen behind the looking glass and seen Ryan seeing the moment, but you didn't. You saw Ryan looking away, Murphy coming out of the entanglement and being able to do some more drops. So that was a nice, really, really nice moment in the match. And Ryan Riley eventually picked up the win, but it was a really strong match. Like I said, I thought coming into this one, Murphy would win it. And that would lead to Zach beating Ted, and then a draw between Dino and Bruiser Brad. So I got them all wrong, but I got the situation right. After that was Dino and Bruiser Brad, and this match was just chaos. It started outside the ring. Dino came out and second and was at ringside, and Brad came out to meet him, and they just had a big brawl. Slaps, chops, clubs, kicks, headbutts, you name it, they smacked each other with it. It was just an absolute car crash of bodies as they just laid into each other. And they were able to... Am I remembering a suplex? I can't remember. I may be misremembering a portion of a match or adding a match. It might have been for Ryan and Murphy, because Ryan did slam Murphy at one point, which is very impressive to watch. But Dino and Brad just absolutely leathered each other for a good period. And it was one of those matches where you watch it and it was just two colossal guys beating each other up, and it was, you couldn't stop watching it kind of thing. And sometimes that can be a little bit hokey when it's just two guys of regular size or like my size, I'm a little bit bigger than regular. It can be a little bit hokey because it's just like, oh, they're barring each other. But these guys are two colossal dudes, like big, tall guys, broad guys, just absolutely slapping each other, and the sound it was making. I think Dino looked like he had like chest hair was missing from a handprint kind of thing. It was just really great, and that's what the variety show that WrestleZone provides really had, was that moment. So it was really just an excellent match. Dino picked up the win. Like I said, I thought this was going to be the one that would be the count out or no contest, but nope, Dino picked up a straight win over Bruiser Brad. I liked, now I'm thinking about it, Ryan picking up the win over Murphy, these are two primarily tag team guys now. Murphy didn't have a great record in singles, if I remember rightly, but Ryan has got a bit more of a singles performance accolade attribute to him. He had that really great match at the start of the year against Aspen at Summer Station Hotel Showdown. So he's got a little bit more of in-ring singles kind of prowess. And then Dino possibly has a bit more of a in-ring singles prowess over Brad. I don't know, does that make sense? Does it? Because Brad's more tag team guy. He did have that some of those big singles matches as well. I don't know. I'm rambling. I'm havering. Let's move on. So yeah, two really great matches to kick off the show, along with the pre-show match as well. It was just a lot of fun. Triple Threat was Lost Boy Aspen defeating Rhys Dawkins and Damien. And this was just all about a book, which, when this match was announced, it was a bit of an odd match. You know, it was kind of a bit of a thrown together. It was a non-title, bit of a thrown together thing. Rhys Dawkins being thrown in there. Damien and Aspen and had their other thing last year. So there was a little bit of still residual heat from that. But somehow, in the space of a couple of days of social media, this was all about Rhys Dawkins getting his Book of Shakespeare elbow dropped by Aspen. That was the build-up, and that was what it was built up into the match as well, as Rhys tried to protect his book at any given opportunity, and which made it just all the better, because Rhys is one of those characters where he just has this little quick-witted thing where he's able to shout back and all that kind of stuff. He's able to do that, but it's all about that book that he's protected and used so often to pick up wins, or to pick up wins on behalf of himself and Brian Tucker, that fans just absolutely detest the thought of that book being involved in any other way than seeing it getting ripped up or elbow dropped or something like that. So it was a really, really well put together concept and match. And I just really enjoyed it. I'm, of course, I'm biased anyway, because I'm a big fan of Aspen. But I like the little Belmont moments, Aspen and Damien as well, because they're not necessarily friends. Damien was quite on board with the elbow dropping of the book, but he's still there to win a match as well. So he was able to take advantage of Aspen's zeroing in on that book to throw in an knee at some point, and able to do a little bit of battering himself on Aspen and on Rhys. And yeah, just a really, really fun put together triple threat that I was surprised. I would say I was surprised by it. I wasn't sure how this match was going to go, much like most of the matches on the show. But it was just a really, really fun put together match, with Aspen picking up the win in the end with a great Darkest Lariat. What I will say is Rhys just sold the despair of that book getting elbow dropped beautifully. It was like it was a scene in Platoon with William Dafoe. It was just amazing that, and people reacted to it as well. That this book, it's an inanimate object getting elbow dropped. It shouldn't be something that people react to, but everyone did. Everyone was bought into the concept. People weren't on Twitter or X, wherever it's called, which I think that's its official name now. We're bought into the concept of Aspen just wants to elbow drop that book. That is his goal. He's not here to defend a title. He doesn't need to. It's a non-title match. So he's just here to have a bit of fun, and he's going to elbow drop that book just for his own personal amusement. So, fantastic. So that was the first half. I found myself in the toilets in the interval because it was the only place that was cold. The only place that was cold. That was the longest piss of my life because it was so cold in there. It was wonderful. Not often I will say it's wonderful to go to the toilets in any venue, but for that moment, certainly was. Back from the break, a lot of people were outside as well during the interval, just to try and get any cool down, try and get sweat off them. I bet Hopeful Social Club made a killing at their bar on Saturday, because there was folk just going back and forth, drinks and that, just to try and cool themselves down, because it was just so hot. I mean, there was fans put out, like metal fans put out, and the doors were open during intervals and what have you, the fire doors. But yeah, it was just such a hot venue. I would have hated wrestling in that, because I mean, I'm sitting there anyway, so I'm sweating anyway because I'm not moving. I'm just melting in the heat. But then having to exert yourself and do more movement and having to do that, because the breeze of your moving is going to cool you down, but the exertion of your body is going to heat you up. So no wonder a lot of the wrestlers were just looking like red tomatoes by the end of their matches because of that. Back from the break, Ted O'Keefe versus Zach Dynamite. That ended in a no contest, as I was fairly sure it was going to, after the results of the first two matches between the Foundation and the Outfit. And this was really good. This was all about... So Ted opened it pretty much saying he was going to make Zach tap out. So he's been using that sharpshooter recently, and he was going to make Zach tap out. And Zach didn't take Ted that seriously, because Zach Dynamite's a very accomplished wrestler in WrestleZone. He's won just about everything that he can outside of the tag team championships, which are held by the Foundation anyway. And so it didn't really take Ted that seriously, and even seemed to be not amused, but just generally annoyed when Ted would fight back and try and get an advantage in the match. There was a great neck breaker on the outside, on the wooden floor, which looked nasty. Oh, speaking of nasty, Bruiser Brad looked like he had the shit knocked out of him when he got, I don't know if it was a headbutt or it was Dino's rolling forearm, but something just, he pretty much kind of, it looked like he just went stiff as a board as soon as you got hit, and it looked nasty, and his eyes were glazed over from where I was sitting. And then he came in this match, he came in with that with his head taped up and all that as well. So there was just a lot going on in that particular match, a lot of hard hitting stuff. But for Ted and Zach, they put on really, really fine match. It was just really good. I mean, so there's no bad matches on this show, so it's hard for me just to go, oh, it was a really good match, or because they all were, and I'm just repeating it constantly. But went to a no contest eventually. Ted had Zach in sharpshooter, and it looked like possibly Zach was going to tap out before the Foundation arrived, and quickly followed by the Outfit. And there was a big brawl where everyone was getting thrown about. Evan Young joined in to try and hold back Bruiser Brad Evans, which was incredibly brave for Evan. If he wants to change his name now to Evan Incredibly Brave Young, he can do that, because it was just the sheer difference in size was just hilarious at the same time. But yeah, it was that was the big brawl, as expected. But I just didn't know which match it was going to happen in. So it looks like we're going to get some sort of resolution, hopefully at Halloween Hijinks. possibly Christmas Chaos. Maybe we'll be just in another first chapter, another part of the first chapter, part two. We'll see the first kind of first dance between the outfit and the foundation in a 3-on-3 situation. And then might see it at Christmas Chaos. Not Stonehaven, because I won't be at Stonehaven. So don't make it Stonehaven, please. So penultimate match of the night was Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed defeating Ronan King and Captain Allen. This was hilarious. That's the easiest way to put it. There's so many little stupid moments, which makes it all the funnier. So when Mr. WrestleZone had his bag of gifts, usually it has his extra long tag rope, but he came out with a crown for Ronan King because he's actually a king, and an empty bucket of KFC for Captain Allen, which at some point was placed onto Allen's head as well. There was moments like Ronan King was sitting, declaring himself to be the best 19-year-old wrestler in the world, as you know he does. And then Allen announced that he was the best 38-year-old wrestler in the world. And somehow, I don't know how it works in Grant City, it works in Aberdeen, but figured out that Allen may be Ronan's grandfather, which I don't know how the maths, but I don't know how it works over there. You know, it's just an unknown quantity. Does the granite make your parents younger? I don't know. I'm a little bit scared. But yeah, so that happened. Mr. WrestleZone did a Styles Clash. I feel like nobody's talking about this. I said it in the recap. I feel like nobody's talking about Mr. WrestleZone doing a Styles Clash to Ronan King. That, like, did I imagine it? Because I'm sure it happened. We had Mr. WrestleZone also proving that he's got the hardest arse in wrestling with a bonsai drop, and he even did a little Yokozuna pose afterwards, arms crossed, which is a nice little touch. It was just a hell of a lot of fun. That's the be all and end all of it. It was just a hell of a lot of fun. It was just four guys who are incredible characters, entertaining characters. There was a dance off at some point with Omar doing Bhangra and Ronan doing something. I can't even describe what his dancing was. I don't think I could do it. Certainly not in front of people. A lot of gyrating in this dancing. So with that, eventually Damien appeared on screen and begrudgingly accepted Captain Allen's challenge for Halloween hijinks, and he was going to sink his battleship. And that was enough of a distraction to allow Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed to pick up the win. But no, an excellent match. There was just so much fun. Have I said fun enough? Is there a fun counter? Has anyone want to do a fun? How many times I say fun on this show? But there was just a hell of a lot of entertainment. I was fully sports entertained on this match, during this match as well. So great stuff. And that led us into the main event, Cale Valhalla defeating Mickey Vago and Brian Tucker to retain the Tri-Counties Championship, which, like I said, variety show was definitely the case here. We had the stuff between the foundation and the outfit. We had the silliness of elbow dropping a book in the triple threat in the first half main. Then we had the absolute absurdity of Mr. WrestleZone and Omar Mohammed against Ronan and Captain Allen. And then we got this, which was just generally, it was just two guys barring each other for a bit, a good brawl between Caleb and Vago. And then you had Brian Tucker running about like a banshee on the outside. At some point he got stuck again. But this is becoming a thing on low ceiling venues that Brian Tucker, I think this might be the second or third time he's found himself stuck on the top rope between the top turnbuckle and the ceiling. He's really got to stop doing that. Otherwise people will start calling him a Wally. Oh, maybe they do already. So we'll have that. There was a nice little moment in this. Oh, Vago. Shout out to Vago because he did the absolute cleanest cartwheel back elbow that I've ever seen. He avoided someone. He was in the corner. Caleb ran at him and Vago ducked and did a cartwheel into a back elbow drop onto Tucker. Could be mixing up who was getting hit, but it was so clean. It was just great. You know, there's always that weird thing with cartwheels and all that, or handspring elbows, and that there's just always that little hesitation when their foot lands on the ground, but it was beautiful. We had that. We had Rhys Dawkins come out trying to help Brian Tucker, and Vago tried to use green mist again like he did in Halloween Hijinks last year, sprayed it into Reese Dawkins' face, but Reese was wearing his glasses, so he declared, haha, lifted up his glasses, and then got sprayed in the face again, which, man, Reese Dawkins is a great character. It's just fantastic, just of the absurdity of it. I'd love to see him maybe have like a little bit of a team up with Taylor Wright. I think that would be a good bit of fun, because they both claim to be the most intelligent wrestler. I think that would be a little fun dynamic to see them both maybe try and one-up each other during tag team bout for who's the cleverest of them all. I remember a bit as I'm going through here, because I think Ryan Riley used the turnbuckle, which led Murphy to find himself rammed into it to pick up the win. It's all been, I'll remember more bits as the week goes on. I'll have it on writing. Don't you worry about it. But no, Caleb eventually won with a hell ride. It wasn't the best hell ride in the world. You'll see in the montage, but it did the job, did all it needed to, and defeated Brian Tucker, and he was able to successfully defend his Tri-County Championship. But overall, an absolute fun night, a blast in Inverurie. I really like the getting to the venue as well. I don't have to drive in Aberdeen for one. That's always good, even though if we are doing Aberdeen shows, usually it's Kelly that's there and driving, but she's not come to that show. She didn't come to that show in particular. I don't think she'll be at Halloween Hijinks either, so it'll be myself trying to get to Curl. I'll be fine. We'll be okay. We'll be all good. So I've got that, but it was just a really great night, and I just really enjoy going to wrestling. This is, what, show 4 of the On Tour series, and I've got Ardler Mania next, and I've got a break between, and then it's Halloween Hijinks, Wrestling Showdown in Elgin, and then Christmas Chaos. So there's only a few shows left of my year. Possibly see what happens, maybe we'll get to another one or two, but I'm fairly certain I won't be at Stonehaven for WrestleZone. So I'll just have to keep an eye out for results, and hopefully people will be kind enough to send me some footage my way and I can have a look at it. But for now, I think I've talked plenty. This is going to be a big episode anyway, between the interviews, which I'll put out next week, like on location pieces as well. So if you've gotten this far, you've already seen them. But if you want to see them again, just individually, they will be available. I don't think I'll be putting Ronan's out on its own, though, because out of context, it is not something I should be putting out on its own. So if you want to see Ronan call on Wrestle Fans Kansas again, go back and watch that. So in the meantime, I have been Billy. I have been talking for a very long time about wrestling, and I'm going to continue to do so. This has been SWN Podcast On Tour. Hope everyone is doing well. If there's anything you want on Patreon or what to see in the future, just let me know. I want to know what I can do for you to see more content. If I have time to do it, I will certainly do so. I'm also in the plans of doing some quizzes, or like just ones that you can do at home. I'm planning to do some of them by the end of the year, and so there won't be an SWN podcast. They'll be just outside of that sphere. They'll be just separate things, much like Reese Dawkins doing his Well Perhaps segment. I'll try and do something like that. Will I be talking? I don't know. I might just do it so you can play at home. But we'll see how it goes. But I've got plenty of plans, so I want to do, but I'm always happy to hear more. But in the meantime, have a good time. Hope you enjoyed this episode. Hope you enjoyed the montage, and just keep supporting SWN. Thank you very much. Have a good one. I am joined by Tri-County's champion, Caleb Valhalla.
Skull! Skull! That's a nice tree.
That is a very nice tree.
Big tree.
Can you make that into like a canoe? Longboat.
Mighty Caleb doesn't really like water.
No.
Land lover is the Mighty Caleb. That's why I wrestle.
How did you cope with Captain Allen then in his boat?
No, lots of seasickness. Okay. That's why I'm not with him anymore, aside from the fact that he's an idiot.
That as well. So you're defending the title tonight?
Yes! Against Mickey Vago, Brian Tucker.
Can't wait for it. The bit thing, I'm so excited for this match because, you know, I get to see Caleb. And of course, my wife is very much a big fan of the Mighty Caleb. For now, have you got any final words for your opponents?
I'm going to hit them. I'm going to hit them very hard. Many times. I'm being summoned.
You're being summoned.
Ah!
I'll let you go then. Let you go.
Farewell!